Okay, good morning, everybody, or good afternoon, wherever in the world you are. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Peter Llewellyn. I run the services at medcomsnetworking.com. So those are information services, resources, activities for the global MedComms community, by which I mean medical people who work in and around medical communications, medical education, medical publishing, and indeed people who want to join MedComms. You'll find lots of information resources at medcomsnetworking.com. You'll find stacks of these sorts of video recordings of these sorts of meetings at Network Pharma TV. If you're interested in joining MedComms, you'll find a load of information at firstmedcomsjob.com. And more websites are available. So go to medcomsnetworking.com and see what we're doing. These webinars are great because it means we can involve people from all over the world, either as panelists or as audience. And it's great to see we've got a big audience here today from around the world. But importantly, we've got three panelists in from the States. So thank you very much, guys, for joining us from the US, where it is, I guess, breakfast time. Today, my role is very limited. I'm going to simply say hello and welcome to the panelists, and then I'm going to pop up at the end or come back at the end and say thank you. In the meantime, I'm delighted that we've got three proper experts talking today, and I'm going to let the discussion led by Patti with Tom and Robert. So on that note, Patti, I'm simply going to hand over to you and let you do your thing. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you so much, Peter. We're really happy to be here. Let me share my screen. Does everyone see that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, thank you so much for the invitation to participate with you today. I'm really delighted to be here and to talk about one of my favorite subjects, value communications, and to talk about it with people that are my favorite audience. Individuals that are interested in getting into this field or want to have a better understanding of what their stakeholders are looking for. And I am really delighted to be joined today by two experts who have worked in the trenches of this arena for multiple decades, and two colleagues that I've had the pleasure of working with as we've been building some education around value communication. Let me start out with a brief introduction of who I am. I'm Dr. Patti Peeples, president of healtheconomics.com and founder, and I also hold the role of vice president of evidence and content at our parent company, scientist.com. I've been working in the field of health economics and outcomes research and real-world evidence for about 3.5 decades, since it was really founded in the United States. And I am so delighted to be on the panel today with two experts who really work in the trenches. So Rob and Tom are going to bring some perspectives that I wouldn't be able to bring to the table and to help round out the discussion. Rob, could you introduce yourself, please?
Sure. Good day, everybody. My name is Rob Matheis, president and CEO of ISMPP. Prior to ISMPP, I had the opportunity to lead a few global publication teams, medical communication teams that had a value communication focus in a number of ways. And as Patti mentioned, this is one of my favorite types of talks to give because I think it's one that can be very influential in terms of how we think about value communications and where they fit in the broader strategic plan. So we'll get into this when I have a chance to make a few comments, but I really look forward to discussing today with you guys.
Tom?
Good. Hello and good day, everybody. My name is Tom Drake. I'm the director and founder of Global Outcomes Group. And our company is specifically oriented to provide medical communications to the value communications area within the pharma industries. And we I launched the business in late 2014, but I've been involved in the value communications area for over a decade. And I've been in the industry actually for over 30 years, and I've spent a number of years working in the UK. I worked in Eastbourne with a company now part of the Sanofi group. And again, like with Rob and Patti, it's a wonderful opportunity for us to discuss this growing area of medical communication. So thanks, Patti.
Thank you, Tom. Really happy you're on the panel today with you and Rob. So I know all of you spend a lot of time in front of the computer screen these days, and I'm hoping that this hour that you've been kind enough to share with us turns out to be something that really challenges you and intrigues you about what this particular role could be for you. And I hope that we can build enough excitement around the opportunity that if you choose to dive deeper into this or to take your role in value communications to another level, that you have an understanding of what to look for in order to do this, and probably as important, where to look. And I really hope that it is a worthwhile hour, that we're going to build in a lot of discussion, and I really welcome all of you to start sending your questions in right now, because we're going to weave them into the discussion. Let's start out with a little level setting. Make sure we're all using the same terminology. So what is value? Value in the pharmaceutical industry is and should be based on evidence. And that evidence is derived from the research that is conducted within the health economics and outcomes research field on the economic impact of the intervention, the clinical, which you all have a great deal of experience in, as well as the patient-reported outcomes, which you might have heard referred to as humanistic. I really don't care for that term that much. And so humanistic really means how the drug is affecting the patient from a health-related quality of life standpoint, or a satisfaction, or some sort of quality metric. And HEOR conducts all of that research typically using either adding on to clinical trials in a prospective way that gives you some data, but not data that is very meaningful to payers. And so that is the motivation for the increasing use of real-world evidence, how the drug is performing in the typical arena outside the constraints of a clinical trial. The methodology has improved enormously in this, to where there is a robust and valid use of real-world evidence from a regulatory perspective and certainly from a payer perspective. So HEOR utilizes real-world evidence as well as epidemiology and rolls that up into a compelling value story that is used ultimately for attaining market access, whether it's reimbursement from a payer or on a formulary or on a health system list of approved uses. So that's what value communication and the value story is in a nutshell. What I hope that you can see, that whether you're a medical writer who loves evidence and how to tell that story, or if you are a scientist who really loves to write, but to present a business case for the science, then value communications is a great spot for you. It's utilizing data, raw data, turned into compelling and robust evidence, and it matches with the opportunity in the market. Creating a story. And at the bottom of this graphic here is where we're really in need of expertise, utilizing the skills that medical communications professionals have to create a scientifically evidence-based story, and wrapping in better data visualization so that it communicates specifically to the different audiences. I think one of the things that is very unique about value communications is that our audiences really do vary. And we've got some research that are gonna show you who those audiences typically are. What you should know is that there is enormous demand for value communications professionals worldwide. And I think Tom and Rob would agree it's essential, no longer just a nice to have component. And currently it's not fit for purpose. We don't have enough people to do it, and we don't have really the right tools. What we need are more people that can help plan this process. Rob's gonna touch on this. We need creativity and innovators of new and different ways of communicating the tools that we use, and better storytellers of data. Right now, we have predominantly researchers that are writing this content, and they are not the best storytellers of that data and evidence. We also need people who can test the impact of the value communications tools that we do, that we create, and we need more trainers of people. So if you can fit into any of these roles, then I hope you see that there's an enormous opportunity for you. Value communications is no longer just built around a manuscript. There is the opportunity to be involved in the value chain in so many different ways. If you have a strategic component to your expertise, then there's enormous need from the researchers and the commercialization team to hear your voice in value proposition and development and value comm strategy. For working this value comm strategy into the full drug development life cycle, there is a need for you to participate in creating these dossiers and HDA submissions, of which Tom has enormous experience in. There's a great deal of need for payer-specific business cases. What you will find in this is that this is not a one-and-done kind of thing, that most of the audience for this needs the value story crafted for their particular audience that they deal with. And so those payer business cases are important. Patient and provider facing materials with that value and quality message are important. And then of course, a much more open arena in the regulatory environment. So you can see that no matter what your expertise is or what your interest is, there's a place for you in that chain of value communications. So let's kick off with the question, how are medical communication groups adapting to the increased focus on value? And I can think of no one better suited to help us take a look at this than Dr. Rob Matheis. Rob?
Yeah, thanks very much, Patti. And thank you again, everyone, for taking the time to listen in today. You're all very fortunate today on the phone because I'm going to give you the secrets about value communications and what's happening organizationally, what needs to happen organizationally to be successful. So pay attention, I'm gonna do it fairly quickly. Next slide, please. So I like to start off my presentations by basically telling you the punchline in the beginning. There's three things that I'm hoping that you're going to learn today from today's discussion. The first, and Patti set this up very nicely before, is that real world evidence is absolutely necessary. And regardless of how you want to term it, and thank you for going through the terminology, Patti, very effectively. It's not just that it's needed, it's not just that it's important, it's absolutely critical when we think about the healthcare landscape from a global perspective. The second thing, and I'll talk more about this in a moment, the second thing that I'm hoping that you'll learn today is that once you own number one, the way in which you go about doing this type of evidence or value communications is it needs to be highly proactive. And we'll talk a little bit about this, but I think up to date, you know, in a lot of ways, our profession has been a little bit more reactive in a lot of ways when it comes to value communications. And the time to change that is actually now. And we'll get into that in just a moment. And then the third thing that I'm hoping that you'll walk away with today, and this is a really important one, is that once you buy into number one and number two, it's very easy to just say, I'm gonna check the box and I'm gonna get that HEOR communication together, or I'm going to add this to my publication plan. And I wanna kind of put some holes into that a little bit and ask that you do more of an integration than an addition. And we'll talk about that. So this is a subject matter of about 8 hours worth of conversation that I'll do in about 5 minutes. Okay, next slide, please. So I'm gonna take it up a notch a little bit and ask you to think for a moment about what's in your garage or maybe what's in your neighbor's garage. And I know, you know, many of us have many automobiles that we may like, and I will get to a point, I promise. But in this particular garage, we see a shiny X5 and a more of a beat up pickup truck, right? And both have their uses, of course. But, you know, I want you to think about perhaps your neighbor's garage and if these two things were sitting there. Next slide, please. And I ask you the question, which is the better automobile? And if you just kind of close your eyes for a moment and think about it, I want you to consider which one, you know, off the cuff response, might you think is the better automobile? And I suspect probably a number of people on the line today might knee-jerk reaction say, I'd love to wake up in the morning and find that shiny black X5 sitting there. Maybe not so much the F-150, but it remains to be seen. People have different tastes. But now I want to take this example for just one moment and ask you on the next slide, please. What if it's a beautiful Saturday morning and you wake up and you decide you want to mulch your nursery, your garden, and you decide you're going to go down to the local shop and pick up a bunch of mulch. The question I have for you is, do you want to load that mulch into your shiny X5, or do you want to put that into the back of perhaps maybe that pickup truck? And the reason I ask that question is because, you know, in a lot of ways, the type of tool that we use depends on the need. And so by extension, I'll bring it now back to the subject matter of today. A lot of ways, and a lot of times, we think about evidence as kind of on this pyramid. And oftentimes, and I've been doing this gig for a while, along with Patti and Tom in different ways, we think about evidence and we often see it as part of a pyramid or a hierarchy. But the reality is, one type of evidence is not necessarily better than the other. They're answering different questions. And the reason why I bring this up, and it goes back to a point that Patti had made earlier, is that depending on the need and depending on what you're trying to accomplish, you're going to pull from your toolbox from different areas. So one of the things I really try to push when I give this presentation is to take that pyramid, flatten it down. And for you sitting in either a publication professional seat, medical writer, whatever walk of life you happen to be in, I want you to think about the different types of evidence that are available. And so when you go out to your garage in the morning and you might want to choose between your shiny car or the F-150, depending on the purpose that you have, you may select from different types of evidence. And this is a mindset that's critically important. When you go back to your day-to-day jobs, I want you to think about, are you addressing all the different needs? Are you pulling out the right automobile for the right need, depending on whether you're developing a dossier, depending on whether you're trying to talk with a payer, someone at point of care, making a healthcare decision, there's going to be a different tool, and one is not better than the other. Okay, so if we can go to the next slide. So the point that I made initially, point number one, is real-world evidence is absolutely necessary. Right? I need both those cars in my garage. If I'm benefited enough to have two of them, I'd like to have one that I can take out on a nice day, maybe go on a vacation with, and another one that I can use when I'm working in my garden. So the same is true when it comes to evidence. And when you think about publication planning, medical communications and value communications, you know, there's many questions that we might ask. There's many things that we might want to communicate. And one of those things that we might want to communicate is, does the product actually work? Is it actually safe? And so that's our traditional types of publications that we all do very well. A nice randomized clinical trial handles those confounds very nicely, right? We randomize, we know it works against placebo, we know it works better than chance. That's a laboratory-based evaluation of a particular product, service, or technology. And then we talk about things like efficacy and internal validity, those types of things. But if we leave out, and this is where the absolutely necessary piece comes in, the real-world evidence, observational studies, so on and so forth, we don't actually answer the second question, which is, does this thing actually work in the real world? And I can assure you that the payer community and many other communities that are looking at this evidence, yes, they wanna know that it works, it's safe and effective, but they also wanna know, does this thing work in the population that I'm caring for, the population that I'm paying for? Okay, so when we think about a value proposition of a product, service, or technology, both of these types of evidence are absolutely necessary. And so when you go back to your seats and you start thinking about your publication plan, if you don't have both of them on there, then you're leaving out a full part of, to use Patti's word, the story. Your job in medical communications is to tell a story. And so value communications is a very, very important part of that story. So think back as you're listening to this presentation of whether or not you're actually telling a story or just plopping some HEOR evidence on the bottom of your plan. Next slide, please. So the second point that I made, and this will be a quick one, is you have to be proactive, right? So when I first got into pharmaceutical medical communications, there was the guy down the hall. So I had just joined and I was kind of fresh. I was working at Sanofi and I was very happy working with CSRs and basically putting together manuscripts and, you know, posters and things of that nature. But there was the guy down the hall, you know, and the guy down the hall was the HEOR guy. And I was scared to go down there because I didn't know what was happening down there. This is many years ago. There was tables and there was hypothesis generation and things, Bayesian statistics and all kinds of things. Folks, you got to go down the hall, okay? Don't wait for your HEOR colleague to come to you. If you're sitting on this call today, one of the secrets that I want you to know is don't be afraid. Go down there. You need to go and integrate with the folks that are doing this type of evidence. And the reason I say that is because it's an important part of the story. And because they need you, whether they know it or not, they need you to be part of telling their story. Not to say that they're not experts in their own regard. And some people on the phone today may actually be experts in HEOR, real world evidence, and so on. But we need to be working together. So on the next slide, I can assure you that the people on this line have evidence or have knowledge, skills, and expertise that probably aren't seen across the broad organization. And some of your HEOR colleagues might not know what you know. In fact, I'm sure of it. So about doing targeted medical writing, right? Knowing how to address a particular audience, as Patti had mentioned, the way in which that we communicate with different types of audiences is very different. We on the line today are experts in this. This is our profession. Compliance, how to do a gap analysis, all these crazy terms that we have and we are terms of art are not necessarily part of the fluency that our colleagues have. Best practices, how do you measure the impact of a publication? How do you integrate in the broader plan? Digital extensions, lay summaries, and all this stuff that we swim in every day is not the language of our colleagues. They need you. So be proactive, go down the hall, and don't be afraid. That's point two. And then the third point, and I love this one because once I get people to the point of getting number one and two, they say, okay, Rob, okay, we'll go down the hall, we'll get the evidence, we'll get the data, and I'm gonna put this on the bottom of my plan. Don't just add the HEOR evidence to the bottom of your plan. When you go back to your seats and you're ready to go and work on a strategic communication plan for a particular product, service, or technology that you may be working on, I want you to think about it in terms of integration. And it's subtle, but it's important. It's one thing to go, okay, give me your plan, colleague, and I'll put it on the bottom of my publication plan after I get through salami slicing all the CSR data and everything else that I've been doing to try to get a medical voice, if you will. What you really want to be making sure that you're doing is integrating that evidence in. At what point in the story is it important to reach out to that payer audience? And what types of communications do you want to have? What congresses should you be going to? This is really the expertise that goes into our profession. So if you're not thinking proactively about the flow of communication, the story that you're trying to tell, right, what you're trying to communicate at a particular time and interweaving that into your communication plan, then you're probably not being as effective in telling the story as you can. And I can assure you, these types of communications, value communications, should not be afterthought, right? We live in a world today where having that effectiveness message, not just the efficacy and safety, but the effectiveness message as to whether or not something works in a particular population at a particular time, personalized medicine and everything else we're getting into these days, then you don't have a full publication plan. So your takeaway from this particular slide is please, please, please think about the integration of your evidence as part of the broader plan. I think that was my last one, Patti, if I'm not mistaken.
Is. Rob, thank you so much. That was a great setup. Audience, I would love to hear from you of when you are typically approached by your HEOR colleagues to start working on some form of publication plan. Are you driving in? Are they coming to you? At what phase? And what are your challenges internally? Send us a message in the chat box if you would. Rob, you talked very clearly about when you first started that you were nervous to walk down that hall. After you've led departments and have the position that you do at ISMPP, where you see across lots of organizations, what are some important steps and changes that a group in pharma would need to take in order to better support the transition to value communications? Really, like, what are some real changes that they can make organizationally?
Yeah. That's a great question, Patti. And again, I probably need a couple hours on this one, but I'll do it in 1 minute. So at the very highest level, if you're sitting on this call and you happen to be in a position to organize or reorganize the way in which you shape departments to work together, I would say it's important to try to put together pods of departments where you have something around a therapeutic area where people are working together, bringing different types of evidence into a broader plan. And so organizationally, people sitting in chairs together working in pods, whether it's informal or formal, makes a lot of sense. When I look across organizations, I've seen different companies respond to this in different ways. And for our colleagues and friends on the agency side, I've seen how you've had to respond as well in terms of how some of these organizational changes have been made. The most popular change that I've seen though, that I think is, and it's highly effective, is whether it's formal or informal, is setting up working groups that basically are focused on the type of evidence being brought out as opposed to simply working off the studies. In the past, organizationally, we saw many groups like MedComms groups would be responsive to studies. They'd wait for the clinical team to send the stuff down the pipe and then they'd go and they'd use it. What works better and what your colleagues are doing across organizations and your clients are doing, quite frankly, is basically trying to organize themselves in ways where they're bringing together a multidisciplinary approach. And if you don't have that in your position to drive it, colleagues, then I highly recommend that at the very least go down the hall and not just put a meeting on the calendar, but bring multiple people together so that organizationally you have people working together to think about the evidence communications that need to happen.
Mm-hmm. So Becca tells us that she works in MedComms and she has consultancy colleagues in market access. What we have learned through the value communication survey, which we're going to share a few more details about that in a few slides from now, is that market access and HEOR don't want to be the holders of the knowledge. They really want the medical writers and the publication planners to have a body of knowledge. How should they go about organizationally achieving that, Rob, in order to really own this knowledge set?
Yeah, so another great question. One of the things that I think is really highly effective is to better, as and I'm talking specifically now to folks on the line working in a medical communications type of capability, is to learn just a little bit more, and we're gonna talk about training in a little bit, to learn a little bit more than you currently know about your environment. So everyone on the line, I'm sure, is an expert in either medical writing, publication planning, compliance, you name it. But what's going to make it effective, and this is both organizationally but knowledge-based, is if you know a little bit more about market access. What are the types of evidence? What's a formulary decision? What's health technology assessment on a global basis? If these are words that don't like almost immediately resonate with you, then it may be worth a little bit of time to think about that. Or go sit down organizationally with your market access and your HEOR colleagues. They're not often the same people. In these organizations and big organizations, they're totally different departments. But you as a MedComms professional, it's a point I was gonna make later, you're the organizing force. You know, you're the common thread because everything is coming to you in your strategic plan. And although you're working with all these different departments, it's your job to organize them in a way and to bring it together into a common plan. So reach out to these folks, make them your friends, learn their language a little bit, and you'll be much more effective. That's a great question, Becca.
Thank you, Rob. So let's take a look at some of the value communication tools. Let's put some meat on the bones of what we mean by this. Who are they developed for and what do they look like? To give you some insights in this, healtheconomics.com fields every 2 years a value communication survey. We're on our second one in this longitudinal survey. It's currently in the field. We welcome your participation in it with the link below. You can visit healtheconomics.com and jump onto that survey. Within that, we have about 92 who have participated in this interim analysis that I'm sharing with you. Participants come from four groups. Evidence developers are the researchers themselves. Evidence translators are the writers and the communicators. The evidence communicators at the point of customer, and that's your health outcomes liaisons, or in some organizations, MSLs communicating that. And then the receivers, the payers themselves. And we asked them, the developers specifically, where are they spending the most of their time in terms of value communications tools? You see the graph here, that slide decks are the most common. And these are payer-specific slide decks with an individual perspective for the payer that they are talking to. So as Rob talked about, presenting that value story in a very customer-specific way. Manuscripts are still important, but over the years that is diminishing in importance. And what we see are some of those down on the right end of this graph, white papers, web content, dossiers, ebooks and videos are new. So we continue to see a much greater array of tools that are being developed for that value message beyond just the simple manuscript. And then in the orange bars above that, you'll see to whom those are directed. Payers and HTAs are the predominant focus from market access. And then providers who are specifically making value-based decisions are the second most important. What has really grown in this is policymakers and patients, a very significant increase over the past couple of years. And Mitchell's just asking me to say again, who the evidence translators versus the communicators are. The translators are typically the MedComms groups, whereas the evidence communicators, and I probably need a little bit of a different terminology there. Thanks for pointing that out, Mitch. Those are the ones that are on the front line actually delivering the message. So in field-based communications professionals. So if we ask those evidence developers, what do they think about the quality and the availability of people to develop these value communications tools? One way of answering that question is looking at how much they outsource, meaning how much the researchers are looking to others to help them with this. And this is a really astonishing graph to me every time I see the data. More than 50% outsource absolutely none, meaning those researchers are writing the content. And we are not the best ones to do that. You have the skill set in this. But the reason there is a limitation, I think, has to do with process. Rob's alluded to that. I think it has to do with confidence within the MedComms arena. And it has to do with the perspective of what the researchers think the knowledge and skill level is of the writers. Researchers do feel that there's still a lack of medical writing expertise in this specific area, with a desire for a much deeper curiosity around real-world evidence and market access. So I really like that term. Let curiosity drive you in this area, just like you would if you were taking on a new therapeutic area. You need to be an expert in this, or at least have a good working knowledge of what those customers understand. You don't need to be able to conduct that research, but you certainly need to understand what these terms mean. And there's also a feeling that the specific language of the customer is not well understood. And with this one, my best recommendation to you is to get out in the field if you can. Take an opportunity to have a conversation with a payer. There is nothing ever beats listening to the customer. I think also the researchers feel that medical writers with a general expertise, they're looking for someone with a specific skill set. So that's what we're hoping to give you some insight into how you can build up this skill set here. And then the last one, Rob beat this drum, HEOR is often an afterthought on the publication plan. With that, let's take a look from the perspective of a very busy and well-versed communications agency that is specializing in value communications. Tom?
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Patti. And again, hello, everybody. I'm just going to spend a few minutes just to highlight some of our activities. Again, as Patti mentioned, as a specialized MedComms agency that where we focus in the HEOR space. So Patti, the next slide, and I'll just run through some of these pretty quickly. I thought it would be interesting looking at what both Patti and Rob has set up, just to take a look, and I've actually looked at some of our recent submissions and publications, and I thought it'd be interesting to see how in this HEOR space, we're actually evolving interestingly into the clinical realm. And when I look at this list, actually only about out of 15 or so journals, only about five are very specifically oriented in the HEOR space. And what we found is it's an example of the rollout of more real-world evidence from our pharmaceutical and medical device clients and biotech clients. And what's interesting is when we when we start a project, we will be talking to primarily the HEOR real world evidence colleagues. And what we're finding is if we reach out to editors of some clinical journals with our clients and the topic, many times the clinical focused journals will be very interested in this information. And so you can see that we're in a sense blending some real world evidence into the clinical sphere. But you can see, for example, with JMCP and some other market access focused journals, we're still heavily involved there. But it's just interesting to see the evolution into our clinical space. Next slide, Patti. Just a quick snapshot of some of our work. And after looking at Patti's slide about projects, we're primarily delivering manuscripts and posters currently. I'm just thinking about some of our current writing projects. We also are doing a lot of dossier work based in the US. We do primarily more AMCP, which is a very specific US-based dossier, than global value dossiers. What's interesting is as we build out our relationships, we're finding, for example, doing more database, raw database analysis. We have several biostatisticians where we can work with the generators, as Patti mentioned in her slide, generators, to start putting together the actual evidence. But one thing, again, I want to pick up on what Rob said is what I find, having been on both sides of the desk, if you will, as well as being in MedComms before HEOR really took off 20 some years ago, is the idea of building these pods. I like Rob's point about pods. I'm seeing that in some clients and I'm not seeing it in others. And what we try to do at Global is to build those bridges where we can talk to both the clinical folks as well as the HEOR real world evidence folks. Next slide, Patti. So here's what's interesting from a writing communications point of view. When I was putting together this, several of these slides, but this one in particular, I was thinking about a number of our writers. Many of our writers have come from, frankly, from bench science when they were postdocs, and they slowly gravitated into the value communication space. But the point is, skilled communicators are essential across any type of medical communications. So what we look for when we're bringing in a new writer or a new analyst is their ability to synthesize and analyze information. We're looking at primarily tables and spreadsheets. We just had a call a few days ago with a client with, I don't know, I think there were 30 tabs from an Excel spreadsheet. So we want a writer that can look and synthesize information. But again, going back to an earlier slide, the interest in storytelling, because whether you're talking about a clinical trial or a patient registry or a case study, we're talking about communicating a story that resonates with the reader, whether it's a payer, whether it's a formulary group. And again, from a communications point of view, it almost doesn't matter where you sit from a responsibility point of view, but understanding the objective of the deliverable. I know this, I think it's just important for all the team members to understand what the objective are, who you're talking to, and to be able to communicate effectively as a team. And again, this is a team effort. Next slide, Patti. Okay. So thank you all. Just wanted to recap agency life on our side of the fence.
Thanks, Tom. That's really helpful. We have a question from Sridevi. Is to initiate discussions with payers, if they don't have time for a manuscript, a traditional publication, what are some of the most appropriate deliverables? What are your clients doing?
I think you mentioned earlier about white papers and case studies. There's a mechanism such as a white paper case study that can be referenced, but it can be done relatively quickly and turned around. I noticed you also showed slide decks. We've done a number of slide decks for clients where literally we would put together something as simple as a 6-slide unit to go out to a payer or a formulary team that addresses a specific topic. And those slide decks can be developed and reviewed and sent out very quickly to address a very specific topic.
Tom, can a traditional medical writer move into a value communications role? And if so, what should be their first step?
Sure. The large answer is yes, because half of the writers that are on our team come from clinical writing. As I might have mentioned earlier, many of them, either PharmDs or PhDs, came through traditional MedComms and gravitated either by project work or by focus into value communications. What I would say is working in the real world evidence space rather than, let's say, a budget impact model that requires certain analytical experience or skill sets, but real world evidence, whether you're talking about patient registries or patient reported outcomes, those would be areas that an experienced writer could work in and succeed very well. Again, many of our writers come through that area, and we try to get a few new writers to get into the real world evidence first before we would push them into or ask them to help with more of an outcomes specific topic.
Thanks. And for those you that are in a more traditional role, we've got some resources that we're going to share with you if you want to begin building that skill set. Let's talk about it. What kind of training is needed and how can you get it? So going back to the value communication survey, looking specifically at the medical writers, 85% desire more training opportunities, so the demand is high. Unfortunately, in at least 1 out of 2, the company supports getting training outside the organization, and 1 out of 2 have some form of access to training inside the company. If you do not have a formal path within your organization, we're going to show you where you can avail yourself of some resources. Now, what areas, if you look at the colored boxes on the right, do the audience of participants think they need the most work in and knowledge in has to do with real-world evidence and developing a story specific from a customer's perspective, as well as some of those very common things like systematic literature reviews and gap analyses, but applied to the HEOR area. What kind of training is specifically desired? Webinars is what people are looking for most, or associated conference workshops. Fortunately, organizations like ISMPP, ISPOR, DIA, all of those put a lot of effort into providing you with really excellent content. So I hope you begin to dive into that. Rob, can you talk a little bit more about what some of the options are at ISMPP, please?
Sure, sure. So I think from the broadest perspective, we've done a really decent job of trying to overview some of the different types of training that people can do. But I think where people can really think real world about what they can do next, no pun intended, is to think about 3 major buckets, either some type of academic programming where people can work with a university that has training programs that are now specifically aligned to addressing medical communications as it relates to value communications and HEOR. Professional associations, and I'll double click there in just a moment with regard to ISMPP, and then work experience. As Patti mentioned, I think there's a lot of ways that people can get on the job training and things of that nature to get their resources up to speed. So within ISMPP, I'd be remiss in not mentioning, we've really tried to make a transition to addressing real world evidence needs and value communications. And that's something that's happened over time because the environment has changed, quite frankly. So our university sessions now very regularly will have opportunities to learn more about value communications, HEOR, and so on and so forth. Our podcast series will more squarely address that moving forward. Of course, our live meetings now have value communication components built into them. And then we're building a number of partnerships. Probably the most visible and far along is one we have with the University of Florida. where there can be discounts for ISMPP members who are able to avail themselves of the training opportunities there in their program. But I do want to acknowledge, just picking up on a couple of the points made both by Grace and by Tom in the Q&A, you know, it can be very frustrating. I understand that to try to integrate and to get access to some of these teams, some of these resources. And so, you know, as we're going through these presentations, I can almost hear everybody's wheels turning and saying, well, yeah, I understand and I agree with that, but it doesn't work. The training area is one where you actually have most control, right? So when you think about it, you may not be able to directly build those pods right off the bat. You may, on the agency side, for example, may not be able to get right in the door. You will over time with persistence. But the one common currency that you do have available to you that you have control over is your training. So think about that as you walk away from this presentation, this webinar. Think about what you can put into your own individual development plan tomorrow so that you better prepare yourself to do the things that you need to do in your organization. Thanks, Patti.
I love that perspective of what is in your control. And as Grace on the line says, that she wonders how she might be able to actually talk to a payer. Well, some of these things that Rob is laying out, I've personally presented on panels at ISMPP with other payers. And so if you participate in some of these association-based training, there is usually a mixture of a panel that includes payer perspectives, many times a patient perspective, as well as a researcher perspective. And I encourage you to go to those and then take some time after the presentation to go right up there and meet that payer. Those are your opportunities to get face to face with your end customer. So we've touched on a few of those. You will see also ISPOR, International Society of Pharmacoeconomics and Outcomes Research. It is a very attainable membership fee for that organization, and their meetings are outstanding. DIA is putting a lot more effort into particularly real-world evidence. So if you have the chance to take a look at that, they also have a lot of free resources. And then certainly what Peter does and all of his excellent networking opportunities he presents to you, as well as the European Medical Writers Association and AMWA. Rob alluded to if you were going to pursue some sort of academic credentialing, the University of Florida online graduate program has just launched a value communication specialty track. I work with that group. Rob has set up a relationship with UF as a member benefit of ISMPP, and it gives you some real opportunity to get an academic credential in that area. And then there are numerous resources on healtheconomics.com. We've presented a variety of live medical writing trainings focused on HEOR and have all of those decks and information available. So lots of choices for you. And of course, reach out to all three of us if you need further guidance. So let's now, I'm gonna take the screen share off for a moment and let's just have a bit of a panel. Peter, how much time do we have so I can stay on track?
It'd be nice to have just a couple of minutes just to sort of like wrap up the recording, but we've then got a few minutes afterwards with the people on.
All right. Audience, let us hear more from you. I'm appreciating all of these questions. I see one more of a comment from Tom. In some organizations, value communications are led and developed by a different group on a different budget. Value communications often tend to get bolted on to global publication plans. In this scenario, what is key is good communication between the global publication planner and whoever is leading value communications. Thank you. That was from Tom Grant. Tom Drake, what kinds of, who are the people on the phone with you that are hiring you for these value communications projects? And do they typically include publication planners?
It's interesting, Patti. Good question. I would say majority, I don't know, 60, 70% would generally come from a director in the HOR silo. But what I'm finding more and more is we're getting opportunities through the director or managers of pub plans that are seeing all of a sudden this integration of the value communication silo being integrated, and now they need to find someone that can help them with that. And so what we're finding is we're blending our skill set with, let's say, more of a traditional MedComms agency. So we bring the value communications asset while the pub planner or the HOR person is directing the overall strategy.
Thank you. Is training any different for an EU or a UK-based writer with an interest in HOR and real-world evidence versus US-based writers? Rob, let's have you weigh in since you work a good bit with ISMPP across the pond.
Yeah, I think it's a great question. So there are some commonalities. I think they're, you know, the basics of training and getting yourself more familiar with terminology, with basic statistics, you know, things that, you know, might have scared a number of us, as we entered into the field. But we have to have some basic level. So as I mentioned before, you don't have to know Bayesian statistics, but you do have to know the basics a little bit more than just means and standard deviations to be effective. Having said that, once you get that basic foundation, there are differences in terms of the payer marketplace that are going to be different from a global perspective, and the training that you're going to need is probably different depending on the role you have. If it's a global role and you're working across health technology assessment, you have obviously very different types of evidence demands and different parameters around that than you would if you're more in a US-based role where you're doing more with private insurers and then, of course, the global, the government insurers as well. So, but understanding that landscape is step one, and you can learn that online very easily. And then understanding what the different needs are from a value communication perspective is the second step in that process. So that helps.
What's the difference between a market access writer and a market access consultant? Tom, I'm going to throw that to you since you and I played in the market access line together.
So, this is my real world evidence. So we had a project early last fall. And I was actually looking for a market access consultant, and found a very capable person in the United States in Southern California. What I found, though, is that this particular person was very happy to consult, but not very happy to write. And so we actually talked with one of our colleagues that has written a number of projects with mostly slide decks and some web content, and they worked together over the course of a couple of weeks. So the consultant was helping drive strategy and focus, and then communicating that to an experienced market access writer. So it worked out okay, but it wasn't a natural fit immediately.
We have a comment from an individual who works in a value comms agency in the UK, and this is their core focus. They indicate that a key challenge in medical communications, and specifically value comms transition, is a lack of commercial awareness or a lack of understanding of who the payers are and what they are interested in. I absolutely love this comment because this is an agency writer manager who is really paying attention to the very end customer. So they note that is the a really missing piece. And I would suggest that if this area seems really overwhelming, I would recommend that you look at, from an end customer perspective, look at NICE and how NICE evaluates, and focus on ICER from the US perspective. If you begin to get a sense of what those two decision processes are by those two bodies, then the rest of the world is going to be a little bit easier. Any other advice that from the panel about how to keep the customer as an end focus and to gain awareness and knowledge there?
just real fast, all I would say is you mentioned field staff. It's always valuable to touch base with your field staff and hear what they're hearing, frankly, as my boss used to say, at the sharp end of the business. So always keep in touch with the director or the field representative to get that 360 feedback.
I am getting a little note from Peter here that he wants to include our formal presentation. So what I'm going to do is quickly share the screen one more time, just to give you the contact information for the three of us. And you will find that everyone on the panel welcomes your interaction with us. Please reach out if you've got questions or follow-up. So I'm going to leave that on there. And Peter, how do you want to handle it? Should we just go for a few more Q&A, or you want to conclude?
Can we just, for the purpose of the recording, I'd really like to stop there because we are a little bit over time, and I hate stopping these discussions, but I do like to sort of stick to the timing. So huge thank you to the three of you. There's loads of great information in there. I would, again, support what you've just said, Patti. If anybody's watching this today or indeed on the video later on, to follow up with you guys via those contact details or via LinkedIn, which is an easy way of doing it. So huge thank you for your presentation and your discussion and the way you weaved in the questions into the discussion worked well. And thank you to the audience for joining us. I'm going to close it down now for the recording. We'll have a couple of minutes left for those of you online, but for the recording, thank you very much. I'm going to say goodbye. And if we can all just give a little wave, then that would be great. If anybody wants to see the recordings, Network Pharma TV, anything that we do, medcomsnetworking.com. Take it easy, guys. Bye.